Hello everybody, a very warm welcome to the next webinar on COPIS from LASSIB. And we've some of you have been with us in the past webinars as well, and it's a great pleasure to see you back here. I hope you are getting the benefit and the value out of these webinars, and as always we look forward to your feedback on how we can constantly improve. So today's webinar is titled COPIS, and this is one of the very, very popular tools that we use during the measure phase of Six Sigma. Not only that, I mean, don't worry that if you've not done Six Sigma or you're not going to be doing Six Sigma, you will not be able to use this tool. The beauty of Six Sigma and its tools is that you can use just one tool if you want to, apply it and improve your systems and processes. So COPIS as a standalone tool is very, very effective as well, and even more effective when used as part of the Six Sigma methodology. So today we'll be understanding what is COPIS all about and what made it transition from the CIPOC earlier that it was, and why is it called COPIS now. We'll share some live examples of how COPIS has been used, and hopefully you will benefit from it. And again, as always, please feel free to share your feedback on the same. This is Shilpa Kota, and I'm the secretary with the Lean Six Sigma International Board. I also have with me Mr. Varun Khare, who is the coordinator of LASSIB, and he's also been very actively participating in the previous webinars and giving a lot of presentations around Six Sigma tools, not only as part of the LASSIB webinar series, but outside of the webinars as well. So we look forward to inputs from Mr. Varun Khare as well, and with further ado, we get started with the webinar. So covering some ground rules, as always, for those of you who've been with us all along, this is a repetition, but please bear with us with due respect to those who've joined us for the first time. So we cover the introduction of the presenter. The total duration of the webinar is about 45 minutes. We keep 30 minutes for presentation and Q&A question and answer for the last 15 minutes. How do we handle question and answer is through the chat window. You would see the chat window on your, there's a small panel which comes towards the right hand side of your screen. Just click on the chat button there, and you will be able to type your questions. We will be taking the questions in the last 15 minutes, so please feel free to keep typing in your questions wherever you feel the need to, and just remember that we'll not be taking them or answering them during this webinar, but towards the end of the webinar. Again, this webinar is also being recorded, so you can view the webinar recording on LASSIB website later on if you want to refresh or review any of the material later on. The past webinars recordings are also available there. The presentation of the webinar, if you just want to see the presentation and not hear the recording, the presentation will also be available for professional members and corporate members. So please feel free to register as a member, or if you have any specific requests, feel free to coordinate with Mr. Varun Khare at the contact details mentioned below. If you're not able to note them down, don't worry. They are also available on the website of LASSIB, that's LASSIB.org. Okay, so with that, we get started into the topic for today, and that's COPIS. And before we get into COPIS, we'd like to kind of try and understand how the definition of quality has transformed from what it was earlier to what it was now. I'm sure we've touched upon this concept in a little while in our earlier webinars as well, and but this is so important to understand before we can understand why COPIS, that even if it sounds repetitive, we would like to kind of reinstate this definition of quality before we actually get into the details of COPIS per se. So earlier, when the definition of quality, or when quality, when the importance of quality actually started being realized in both the manufacturing sector and the service sector, people used to view quality as defects. If a product is zero defects, then the defect is good quality. Or if a certain process helps us in reducing cost, then the process is a good quality process. Or if we can meet the requirements of a suppliers, I know how to make good coffee. So if I can open a coffee shop, then I'm assuming that I'm providing good quality coffee. to, you know, the customers out there. So it was all very, very, one-sided kind of an approach where we were always trying to analyze things from the point of view of how we know how to do it. I have a certain process. I generate certain goods out of it. I know of certain defects that could be improved, and I am trying to improve the process from my point of view, right? But now, given, you know, how fast the, you know, economies have changed, how globalization has impacted, how aware the customer has become, the whole concept of quality has completely changed, right? So it's no longer about what I can do or what I know best or what, you know, the supplier, my suppliers know how to do it, but it's all about what the customer wants. I don't, you know, the customer doesn't care whether you can make good coffee or not. The customer cares about whether he wants to drink coffee or not and how he wants to drink coffee. So it does not really matter to the customer that you provide, you know, Brazilian coffee, which is the most expensive and the, you know, and the smoothest and all that. The customer just cares for Nescafe probably at the end of the day, right? So even if you're providing Brazilian coffee, you will be pretty soon out of business if you're amongst customers who do not want that, right? So, very simple example, but I hope it makes the concept, you know, of quality clear. It's no longer about, what I know best, but about what your customer expects from the process and what the customer needs are, right? So it's quality definition, and that's the definition that most quality gurus now talk about, is quality is meeting the requirements of the customer. You know, it's conforming to customer requirements, and even if the customer requirement says, hey, I don't want boiling coffee, I just want cold coffee, you know, and you give them cold coffee, then it's meeting the requirements of the customers, and it is good quality for the customer in the eyes of the customer, right? So do not try and define customers' requirements yourself. Do not, basis what you know best. I know how to make hot coffee, so I'm going to deliver hot coffee to the customer. Ask the customer what they want, and therefore deliver it to them in the way they want it, right? And COPIS is just a framework which helps us deliver the customer's requirements in the way the customer wants it. So let's look at how it works, right? So COPIS stands for customer, output, process, input, and supplier, right? Let's look at each one of them in more detail. Customer is pretty self-explanatory. I think the customer who wants coffee is a customer here. I'm just going to take that example for the rest of the presentation, just for the ease of, you know, for the ease of explanation. So the customer is the end, user of the goods or the service that we are actually delivering. Output is what customer expected. The process is, what is the process or what is the way we deliver the output that the customer wants us to deliver? The input is the input that the process needs to deliver the output that the customer wants. And the suppliers are the list of, you know, vendors or the manpower or the people who supply the inputs that the process needs to deliver the output that the customer wants. Sounds confusing, so don't get worried if it's not so clear right now. We are going to look at a lot of examples going forward, which I'm sure will help you understand, you know, what each one of them means in detail. So, as we said earlier, you know, COPIS is all about a customer-driven approach. It starts with the customer, and it aligns your whole process, your inputs, your suppliers to what the customer wants. If something is not meeting the requirements of the customer, no matter how beautiful, no matter how fancy, no matter how tasty, whatever it might be, if the customer doesn't need it, it has no place in the process that you have. You do not need those inputs, and you do not need to you do not need to essentially worry about those, because those are not requested by your customers, right? So essentially start with your customer, focus on the requirements that the customer has, and just deliver those. And that's what COPIS helps us to deliver. Okay, so some of the benefits of COPIS, and I'm sorry my slides were stuck there for a couple of moments. I think it's pretty self-explanatory. If you focus on the customer and help and deliver what the customer wants, then in return you are ensuring that your process is customer-oriented and therefore ensures customer delight. Once the customer is delighted, it means a higher return on investment for our business. And in also better process management. How better was process management? I think we look at a couple of examples to see why and how COPIS can help us deliver, you know, better process management. But I think the other three are pretty self-explanatory, because we started keeping the customer in mind when designing our process, then defining what outputs the process needs to generate, what inputs we need, what suppliers are going to provide those inputs. It's all about keeping the customer in mind and making sure that the customer is delighted at the end of the day, keeps coming back to us again and again for the value that we offer, and therefore ensures high return on investment for our business. Okay, so I'll just explain again, you know, how does it help in better process management using an example which is just coming up in the following slide. Again, the, you know, the COPIS as a process or as a tool, how it's defined, this is more of the definition again. So what happens is, ideally speaking, you should do COPIS for each and every product type that you have. So let me, let's go back to the, again, the example of the coffee shop. As product types, I might broadly classify my product types into hot coffees, cold coffees, probably a little bit of, you know, eating the things that go along with it, like sandwiches, burgers, chips, you know, all of them clubbed together as one. So in overall, I would have probably three product categories that I am, product types that I'm servicing to my customers, cold coffees, hot coffees, and, you know, the eating things that go along. So for each one of these, the customers would be different. For each one of these, each customer would have a different set of outputs, right? Let's take an example. So the first, if my first category is cold coffee, right? The customer probably would be, who would probably drink cold coffee? Probably somebody, you know, who's in the, who's in a very, very high, stressful job, does not drink cold coffee. They would prefer hot coffee, right? So my take is probably, people in extremely hot regions would not normally tend to go with cold coffees more than people who stay in cold regions, right? One differentiation. The other would be a younger generation or younger set of people, in my experience, again, I might be wrong there. Younger generation, especially kids, you know, children, prefer to go with cold coffees than to go with hot coffees. So like that, so if you identify your product as cold coffee, your first customer could be actually children. Now, once you've identified children as your customer, the outputs that those children demand are going to be much different than the outputs that your senior citizens or your, you know, professionals, working professionals demand, right? So the outputs, again, are there are different kinds of outputs that we have to keep in mind here, which one is the critical to quality, critical to schedule, and critical to cost. So all, then you're identifying the outputs, you have to keep all these three parameters in mind and therefore identify the outputs that deliver on these. And when you're defining your process and your input, you have to make sure that all three of these parameters are kept in check. You cannot just deliver extremely high quality, compromising on the cost, you know, that that you actually have to pay to generate that quality. Of course, I can give you the best coffee beans using the best machine and the best milk using the, you know, highly trained, 30 years experienced coffee maker. But then, am I going to be making any margins out of the whole business myself? Probably not, right? So all these three parameters of quality, schedule, and cost needs to be very sensitively balanced before they can, you know, before we can actually define the process and the inputs and the suppliers, right? So I hope you have understood so far. If you have any questions, again, a gentle reminder, there should be a chat window on your right-hand side of the screen. Please feel free to add your questions. We are going to start taking a lot more examples, and the process of COPIS should become much more clearer as we move ahead. Okay? So again, if, assumingly, you know, my favorite coffee example again, if you were to do identify the inputs that you need to set up a coffee shop without using COPIS, you know, these would be probably some of the inputs that you might come up with, right? You need obviously a location, you need some interiors, you need maintenance staff, coffee makers, pots, milk, beans, sugar, blah blah blah. And of course, this is just a sample list of inputs. If you are a true professional coffee lover, I'm sure you would have many more inputs in mind. The idea is that, if you do not follow COPIS, no matter how many inputs you add here, you are not sure whether those inputs are really needed for your customer. And secondly, those are the are those the only inputs that you need? There could be other inputs as well. Are you missing out some input which might, if you've not kept that input in mind, might impact the satisfaction that you're delivering to your customer? How do you know? You know, this is just a laundry list of things right now without using a, you know, methodical way of identifying the inputs and therefore the suppliers. The chances that you will have excessive inputs that you need and you might miss on critical other inputs are very, very high. So COPIS, the way COPIS works is it helps us to plot things in a very, very systematic way and helps us to identify exactly what we need and what we have and identify the gaps in the process. So obviously, just a laundry list of things does not help us. And once we start using COPIS, right? And again, this is when we talk about customers. There is only one customer that we have identified here as a part of the, as part of the coffee business, and that's IT staff. And when we say IT staff, it stands for information technology staff. People who usually work in these high-profile information technology organizations like Dell or HP or IBM or so on and so forth. They are, again, if you're working there, I don't need to criticize or ridicule that. I mean, I was a part of that some of those organizations earlier myself, so I very well understand the pressure on time and the need for staying awake beyond your normal sleep hours and the significance of coffee essentially in our life. So I can completely relate to that, which is where we took that example of IT staff here. So if one of your customers is IT staff who likes to go more often with hot coffees, what are the outputs that they this specific customer is looking for, right? They're probably looking for, again, my experience, so feel free to, disagree that no, IT staff might want cold coffees more. I mean, again, this is just an example, so, just bear with me then. So, in my experience, IT staff would usually like to go with tasty coffee, strong coffee, so that they can keep, stay awake much longer. Different varieties of coffee, yes, while most of the days I just want the same, cappuccino that I order, I might want to, try out other varieties as well. And I think very, very important, a cup that can be carried back to my workstation, because I do not have 99% of the time, I do not have time to, relax and sit over my cup of coffee. And I just, get it back and carry it back. So it should be convenient to carry, it should be closed, it should not leak, and, blah, blah. So some of the outputs that we were able to identify. Now, in order to deliver these outputs, there is a certain amount of processes that you need to set up and, make sure that those processes are there so that these outputs are delivered. And the first and foremost process that comes to mind is the coffee making process. In order to deliver tasty coffee, strong coffee, and different varieties of coffee, what is the foremost process that you need to keep in mind is the coffee making process. And all the other processes like facilities management, utilities management, finance management, how do you, how do customers actually pay the bill, how much time the bill processing takes, how is the, change returned to them and all that, also becomes very, very important. So most of you must be familiar with Starbucks, and the popular coffee chain. And Starbucks is, I think, considered as the leading example of, coffee and the way they've transformed the coffee experience for millions of people out there, right? And the focus that they have on each and every process. Now, if you look at it, why are they trying to automate their processes so much? Why are they trying to, introduce the concept of, wallet cards, which you just swipe and your money gets deducted, They're all making those process improvements, keeping the customer in mind. They understand the customer steps into the shop not to spend time on queues, but to just grab the cup of coffee, the right tasting cup of coffee in the fastest time and at the price that they have to offer, right? So I think they've identified that the customer hates to waste time standing in queues, making the payments, collecting the cash, searching for the right amount, of change in their pockets and so on and so forth. And therefore, they've introduced the, concept of wallet cards as part of the finance management process, right? And again, it is not to make their, efficiencies more, but to deliver the happiness and the delight to the customer. So it's all, again, coming from the customer, focus area there. So some examples of the process. Now in order to deliver on these processes and to make sure that these processes are running fine, you obviously need certain inputs, right? So to make sure that the, and I'm going to stick to the first process in, or you know, without detailing the others too much, just in the interest of time here. The coffee making process being the core process and the most important process that the customer might value, we would need to ensure we have the right coffee specialist who know how to make good cup of coffee, right? Again, as I said earlier, not a good cup of coffee as per me or as per you, but as per the eyes of the customer. So considering you've identified your customer, you've also identified probably the geography in which you are based, you also would need to identify, okay, how does the customer want the coffee? You know, how much, how strong, how light? And then there are different product categories in coffee. It might be a cappuccino, it might be an espresso, it might be an Eskimo, and blah, blah, blah. So for each one of those, how do you define how much coffee goes into it, how much sugar goes into it, how much temperature is it, you know, what, how much cream goes into it, how much time the water boils and all that. Somebody needs to define that process. And for that to happen, you need true specialists in that area, right? And you obviously you need the milk and the sugar and all that, but those are not as important as the specialist and probably the machine that is making the coffee, right? Once you have these two right, most of the other, you know, will tend to fall right as well. Now that you have the inputs in place, now you start questioning, okay, so, well, I have the machine and I have the milk suppliers and I have the sugar suppliers and all that, but do I have coffee specialists? And there you see the question mark in the supplier. Probably the most difficult question to answer is, where do I get the right specialist who can tell me exactly the process that is needed to deliver exactly the output that my customer wants? So what happens is when you build this whole, you know, your whole COPIS framework, as we call it, you are able to identify gaps in your process. You're able to identify exactly what your customer wants, exactly what process you deliver, what is the process that will deliver the expectations of the customer, what are the inputs you need, and what are the suppliers needed to fulfill those inputs. Now, if there is a gap in any one of these, the COPIS framework highlights it very, very clearly. Okay, you know, you do not have the right suppliers to provide you the specialist. Therefore, there's a problem at hand. Therefore, you need to do a certain bit more research or either learn coffee making yourself or go to other coffee shops or go to a, you know, go to a university which teaches coffee making or something like that. But there's a problem at hand which you need to resolve, and the COPIS framework helps you to identify that problem, right? So that's one benefit of COPIS, but and obviously that's not the only benefit of COPIS. COPIS is, in a sense, as I said earlier, will also help you point, okay, these are the inputs that you need for making your process successful in order to meet the customer delight, right? If there is certain input that is not required in the process, that is not stated in COPIS, you do not need that input. Let's take for an example, pretty ladies serving coffee. Well, the customer doesn't ask for it. The customer would just prefer to pick up the coffee themselves and walk out of the coffee shop in 2 minutes. That's what the customer wants. The customer does not want pretty, you know, ladies serving them coffee. So even if you had thought about that as an input, when you actually build COPIS, you will be able to realize that that input does not fit into the customer requirements, and therefore you do not need to invest on that input and therefore the suppliers for that input, right? So COPIS has a lot of, you know, advantages over and above just identifying gaps in the process. Okay, so let's look at another example of, you know, engineering colleges and, you know, how, what is the customer for engineering colleges and how, you know, the whole process of COPIS should be built around it, right? So considering when we set up an engineering college, right, who are we trying to attract? Or for that matter, any university or any college that, you know, or any school, so also for that matter, who are you trying to attract? Who's your customer? Of course, it's not the colleges or the universities or anything, but it's the students who are going to come. You know, you have to attract the students in a way that the students see the value, right? So what is the output that the students expect from the school or university or whatever it is? It is placement. At the end of the day, most of us, I mean, very few of us out there just go and study because we just love studying, right? There's always a goal, there's always a, you know, outcome that we expect after we have finished our education, and the outcome is in, to be able to land a job that will, you know, help us sustain our livelihood. So therefore, placement becomes a very, very key, you know, component of it. Of course, you know, the education gives us experience and it helps us to go for higher studies and all of that. Right? So once you understood that output and you build it into the process, the input and the supplier, you would realize that, okay, placement being probably one of the most critical outputs, how is your process needs to be aligned in such a way that it helps the students get the placement, helps the students get the right placement. Therefore, what are the inputs that you need? What should be your syllabus? What should be the courses that you should be talking about? What are the suppliers in the sense? What are the professors? What are the what are the infrastructure that you need to build in order to provide the input that gives you the process and therefore the output to the customer, right? So if you have not done COPIS and you've just set up your college or institution, you might put in courses that you know best. I know how to teach computer technology, so let me teach that. Does it guarantee placement to the students when they pass out? Nobody knows, right? Because you've not really judged it from the customer's point of view. You've not really seen, what are the key critical to quality factors of the customer. So without taking that perspective, if you just go ahead in the traditional way, in thinking, I know how to teach computer, so I'm going to open an institute which teaches computer in the way that I know best, and using, you know, tools that I know best. I am perhaps the best in Photoshop, so I'm going to be teaching Photoshop to all my students for the next 2 years. Well, they'll be experts in Photoshop, but does that mean that they will land jobs outside? Probably not. But if you had identified that the key output that the customer wanted was actually a job at the end of it, then, you know, you would probably have structured your whole curriculum, the courses, the infrastructure, the teachers, not as per your whims and fancies, but as per what the customer wants, right? So that is the power of COPIS. Again, a very fun example when you actually step into the movie theater as a customer, the public being a customer, the output that they expect is usually good movie, good ambience, good food, blah, blah, blah. So the processes that usually go into the movie selection process, how do you make sure that the customer gets to watch a good movie? You have to have a very critical, review process in which movies you are going to be, you know, showcasing. What categories of movies? You probably don't want to show adult movies if you are, you know, situated in an area which is very family oriented, kind of between amongst schools and colleges and that kind of stuff, right? So the movie selection process becomes very, very critical, right? Now, if you think about the movie selection process, the input that goes to the process is actually the movie reels, and the supplier is actually the movie distributors. So in order to make sure that the first and foremost parameter of good movies is achieved for the customer, you need to be in touch with the right kind of distributors who will provide you the right, the right movies, depending on the, you know, again, the customer definition of good movie, at the right price, at the right time, so that you are able to give that experience that the customer wants, right? So it's all about, again, starting from the customer, identifying the output that the customer wants, building it in the process, defining the inputs, and mapping it to the suppliers that will give you that. Final few examples, again, Tata Nano, a very, very popular example from the Indian manufacturing industry. When Mr. Ratan Tata, who was the founder of the Tata Group, the current, you know, leader of the Tata Group, he conceptualized this car in India, you know, where most of the people, his customer, his audience was very similar. The audience that he had in mind was the common man on the ground in India. So India being one of the developing nations, you know, the purchasing capacity of the Indian people is very low. They cannot afford to buy a car which costs more than, you know, $2,000. But having, you know, having a vision of how to deliver a car within $2,000 is probably not possible without having done COPIS very, very well, without having identified who is his customer. His customer is somebody who wants a car in $2,000, that is, wants to drive his small family short distances, without getting wet in the rain, without getting burnt in the heat. But yes, short distances, nothing fancy, only, you know, just meeting the basic requirements of the car. So he identified his customer, he identified the critical to quality parameters that the customer wanted, and therefore built the process, the inputs, and the suppliers around it. And this, you know, the Tata Nano is a world-class example of how we can deliver value, right? If we have the, you know, if we follow the COPIS, you know, right in the true spirit of the word. Flipping the other side of the coin, if your customer is not the common man, but the customer is, you know, the highest elitist classes, you know, out there, probably the princes and the queens and the multi-millionaires out there, your whole definition of customer, the outputs the customer wants, the process input suppliers completely changes. So the focus as applied to a Tata Nano, of course, does not apply the same way to a Rolls Royce, and then because the whole the customer in itself is completely different. So once you've identified the customer, you are able to, you know, identify what the outputs they want, and therefore build on it and deliver the value to the customer. So do not confuse the customer, and do not confuse that the same process can be applied across all products, across all customers. And COPIS is a very good tool that helps us to do that. I think we've covered enough examples. So I will quickly, you know, skip the same example, and you can the next example, and you can probably look it up into, you know, in the in slides later on. I want to highlight a very important point before we close the webinar today. Earlier, when again in the traditional definition of quality, COPIS was non-existent. It was actually called a CIPOC, and there are a lot of organizations that still implement CIPOC, and it was quite sad to see that, you know, they're still talking about CIPOC. Now, CIPOC is just the opposite of COPIS. COPIS says to start from the customer, whereas CIPOC says start from the supplier, and it's exactly the same thing that I was telling you earlier, that if I know how to make good coffee, the way I know how to, and the machines that I have, and the coffee beans that I have, I am the supplier, right? But I cannot use those inputs to develop a process to generate an output that will satisfy the customer, because I have not even understood what the customer wants, right? So CIPOC is just the opposite of COPIS, and S stands for supplier, input, process, output, and customer. So it not being customer-centric, it no longer holds good in the economies of today. Yes, it served its purpose, you know, decades ago, when it was all about, you know, making defects, zero defects and process efficiencies and all that. But in this customer-centric world of today, please do not use CIPOC. Do not confuse between CIPOC and COPIS and think they are the same. Remember to always, always start from the customer and identify the output that the customer would want from the process. Okay, so always remember, who is the king? The customer is the king. And a customer is means everything to our business. No matter, even if you're in the not-for-profit, you know, like LASSIB is a not-for-profit organization, right? So we are not in a business of making money here. But still, you know, our customers are very, very important to us as an organization, which is where we do these webinars to bring out awareness within our customers, and we constantly, it's our you know, constant endeavor to capture more and more feedback from a customer, capture more and more voice of the customer to help us constantly improve in the value that we are delivering to the customer. And that is where your feedback, questions and suggestions are always, you know, most welcome. So with that, I think we are close. You know, we have used up the time of the webinar. I'm just going to quickly tell you that the next webinar is next Thursday at 7:30 p.m. IST time, and the webinar is you know, on another very, very popular, commonly used tool called value stream mapping. So if you want to register, please feel free to, you know, go to LASSIB.org and register for the same. About LASSIB, I'm going to take a minute to talk about it. LASSIB, as I said, is a not-for-profit organization focused on spreading awareness on, you know, not only Lean and Six Sigma, but organizational excellence. You know, whether you are in a business, whether you're actually running a house, whether you're actually running a not-for-profit, a charity, you know, whatever it is, how do you achieve excellence in whatever you are doing? And the concepts of Lean and Six Sigma are very, very powerful in helping you achieve organizational excellence. So, which is where the whole goal of LASSIB is driven. We were founded in 2011, but to our surprise and excitement, we've already touched, you know, 10,000 professionals, either through our trainings or certifications or consulting programs across 40 countries by now. There are different kind of memberships. There are different kind of membership, you know, options that we have as part of LASSIB, and the student professional, you know, professional membership. Then we have life membership and organizational membership options as well. The benefits and the details of how do you become a member are all available on the LASSIB website. So feel free to go and register there. Again, a quick snapshot of the benefits, but I, in the interest of time, I'll not go through them, and you can go through the website for that. So with that, we open, you know, the floor for questions, and I am looking at the chat window right now. So if you have any questions, feel free to ask. Okay, we have question one. Do we use COPIS when designing new process, or can we use for existing processes as well? I think wonderful question, Priya. Definitely, we, you know, I think it's a must-have when you're defining a new process. You should definitely, you know, build in and see, you know, start from what is the process expected to do. Is the, you know, the process is expected to deliver certain outputs to the customer, right? So definitely, definitely use COPIS when you're designing a new process. However, if you, it is also good to use it for an existing process and identify what's the gap in the process. And I'm sure once you apply COPIS to an existing process as well, you will be able to understand that there are, you know, there are improvement areas in your process. And, you know, probably you can even streamline certain, like the example that I gave, you know, about not really needing, you know, beautiful ladies in your coffee shop because the customer doesn't need it. If you will not be able to identify that unless you do COPIS. You know, unless you actually start from questioning what the customer really wants. Your process seems perfect. You know, there's having excess input does not spoil the process in any way, right? Except for adding to your cost. But you will not be able to identify those unless you do COPIS. So apply to your existing processes as well to identify the areas of opportunities for you. Okay, the next question that we have, in many books I see the acronym CIPOC. Does LASSIB use the order? Okay, so I think we have answered that question. Yes, we see a CIPOC in a lot of, you know, books, institutions, organizations still, and this is quite sad, and we are trying to, you know, pass on this message to more and more organizations and associations out there that please stop using CIPOC. And especially when you're in the education sector, you know, it is your responsibility to make sure that you're teaching the right and the latest concepts which are applicable in the world of today. So we've actually been communicating quite actively that, you know, CIPOC should be changed. And it's not that LASSIB has been the derivative and we have formed the COPIS word. There's a lot of organizations out there who also preach and teach about COPIS only now. Okay, the next question that we have is, what if the customer doesn't really know all the qualities they want? Terrific. I think that's a brilliant point. Most of the customers actually don't. And let me finish the question before I answer it. They just know that they want X, but because you are experienced in the subject matter, your experience tells you that if you also offer additional features, qualities that they don't even know to ask for, it would be good. Example, they want particular qualities for a car, but you know that certain safety features would be a good idea, but they did not ask for them. I think that's a very, very perfect point raised by you, Deborah, and thank you for that. You know, it's like when we talk about customer, listening to the customer, you're absolutely right. Most of the cases, customer does not even know what they want. You know, so most of the, when we actually talked about the coffee example and we did the survey, you know, in our own organization and said, okay, so what defines good coffee? And the generic example that we gave is good quality coffee. And how do you define good quality? You know, what goes into making it a good quality coffee, right? Quality in itself is such a vague, you know, definition. If it is not transformed into critical to quality parameters, right? So again, very well said, Deborah. So while, you know, you take certain inputs from the customer as subject matter experts, it is our responsibility also to suggest certain inputs, certain processes, certain outputs to the customer. As an example of safety, definitely you should recommend it to the customer saying, hey, but have you thought about it? In our experience, if you're driving on high speeds and expressways, you should probably consider a car which has good safety features inbuilt in it. But then again, the ultimate decision should be left to the customer. We as the supplier or as the vendor should not impose upon the customer our presumptions of what is good quality for them. Perhaps the customer does not go on high, you know, on expressways at high speeds, and they will only drive a car 5 miles a day at within speeds of 20 to 30. They know what they want. We are nowhere to judge and, you know, assume that they don't know. It is, yes, it is our responsibility to, you know, inform them, educate them, but then it is also our responsibility to leave the final decision for them. Okay, so with that, I think that was the those were the set of questions that we had, and thank you for the appreciation that we've received from all of you. And it's indeed a pleasure to be presenting our thoughts through this medium. And we look forward to your continuing feedback and continuing suggestions on which other webinars you would like to see. If you have any questions about LASSIB, about COPIS, about Six Sigma, feel free to drop a note to us. And we look forward to hosting you again next week on the webinar on value stream mapping. Till then, you have a great day, great night ahead wherever you are. And we'll see you next week again. Thank you so much.